Excelsior, Excelsior, Excelsior,
Excelsior, Excelsior. Still all my song shall be nearer, my God, to thee. Nearer, my God, to thee. Nearer, Excelsior. Angels to beckon me nearer, my God, to thee. Nearer, my God, to thee. Nearer to thee.
Good afternoon, fellow CYC event attendees. Welcome back. So excited to have you back. It is really my privilege and honor to introduce our next guest. He's an awesome fellow. I actually know him really well. We went to church together for a couple of years. He's the kind of guy whose character is forged by reality, by the fire of reality. He's an awesome guy. Mark Miner is his name, and he has a message today called Landmines and the Ultimate Bomb.
Hi, my name is Mark Miner. I'm a chaplain for Prison Ministries, and I'm so excited to be here at the 8th Annual Can You Hear Me Now Youth Conference. And the topic is Restoration 2020. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're so grateful for today and the privilege of, dear Lord, of spending time with you and your word. And so, Lord, we ask that the Holy Spirit comes into our mind and our hearts. And Lord, may we receive the wonderful words of life. This is our prayer, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. My topic today is landmines and the ultimate bomb. Healing from brokenness. Have you ever heard a man talk about being broken? I don't think I've ever heard that before. Most men, if you say you're broke, those are fighting words. We shrug that off. We don't want to hear anything about brokenness. Usually our response is, but I ain't broke, as you see here. Do you see the lady's response? I believe she says otherwise. Where are you headed? Entering into the state of denial. So you're home. There's no place like home. 666 Denial Avenue, Bonehead, California. You live there? Broken. This is the definition of broken. Broken is physically and forcibly separated, not continuous in time and space, subdued, brought low, weakened, and infirmed, out of order, and lacking parts. That's the definition of broken. You are broken if you don't know the six most important questions in life. Who am I? Your identity. Number two, where did I come from? Your origin. Number three, why am I here? Your purpose. Number four, what can I do? Your potential or ability. Number five, where am I going? Your destiny. And number six, the most important question, what must I do to be saved? If you don't know the answer to those questions, you are broken. If you suffer from anxiety, fear, depression, PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, anger, bitterness, resentment, you are broken. If you have other gods before God, bow down or worship other gods, take God's name in vain, ignore God's holy day, dishonor your parents, murder with words and hands, fornicate or commit adultery, steal, lie, covet. If you do those things, you are broken. If you are abusive to others, domineering, aloof, got trust issues, are controlling, have a superiority complex, financial problems, are living and breathing, still in self-denial, we all are broken in some form or fashion. X-rays reveal, the more we look at ourselves, the more we look at life, the more we realize truly we are broken. Let's talk about the original break. Revelation 12, 7 through 8, it says, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not, neither was their place found anymore in heaven. That, my friends, was the original break. Lucifer, son of the morning, broke from God in his presence. Revelation 12:9 says, and that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives the whole world. He was cast out into the earth. Please take note, he deceives the whole world. Revelation 12:12. It says, woe unto the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down unto you having great wrath, because he knows he hath but a short time. The good news is, he hath but a short time. Look at the next slide. John 10:10 says, a thief cometh not but for to steal, kill, and destroy. And if you look at the man right there, he's already did the damage and walking away. He's not even looking at the damage. That's what Satan does. Satan comes as a thief. He doesn't tell you what time he's coming. He slips in there. He still kills and destroys. He likes to plant the landmines. Landmines. Landmines are an explosive mine hidden underground and explodes when stepped on or driven over. In other words, tripped. He loves to plant landmines underneath the earth, hidden. Next thing you know, we're having a good day and something blows up in our face. An explosion. An explosion is a violent release of energy caused by chemical or nuclear reaction. That's what an explosion is. What about landmines? An explosive mine hidden underground and explodes when stepped on or triggered or driven over. How about IEDs? Those are devices that are made up. They're improvised. He loves using disguised bombs to blow us up. 1 Peter 5:8 says, Your adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. And he loves to carry us out, damaged, with our life hanging in the balance. He's trying to devour us. How about this? Proverbs 18:21. It says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. If you look at this young boy, the neck that is around his throat is full of words, angry words, bitter words. That's what Satan loves to do, psychological warfare. He likes to plant those landmines and in our minds, in our hearts. How about this? Proverbs 23:7. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Have you ever thought, I'm a failure, that I was a mistake, I'm lowly, I'm a loser, I'm wretched, I'm a disappointment, I'm inferior, hopeless. All those words, the devil loves it. Psychological warfare. He's planting landmines in our minds and our hearts. How about this? Harsh words do hurt. Hurt people hurt other people. Isn't that a graphic picture? Words hurt. Words do hurt. Matthew 12:37, it says, for by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Man, think about it. A life behind bars because of our own words. It says here, Isaiah 1:5-6, it says, why should ye be stricken anymore? Ye will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick, the whole heart faint. From the sole of your foot unto the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds, bruises, putrefying sores. They that have not closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment. Look at that, man. Isn't that a sad picture? We're stricken. Do we want to be stricken more and more? I love this picture. It's very graphic. It says, Romans 5:24 says, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? This is our scripture here. Galatians 4:4, it says, but when the fullness of time has come, was come, God sent forth his son. Amen. Ephesians 4:9, it says, he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth. Jesus Christ, Lord of lords, our King of kings, lowered himself to the lower parts of this earth. Why did he do it? He did it for us. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Look at this picture here. We have the words hugging that lady. Jesus Christ is the Word. Amen. John 1:14, it says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. When you're feeling low, when you're feeling sad, when you're feeling frustrated, when there's bombshells going all around you in your mind and in the house and in the community and church, remember that the Word, Jesus Christ, was made flesh and he dwelt amongst us, and we got to behold his glory through his Word. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Philippians 2:8, it says, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of a cross. Matthew 28:18, and Jesus came and spoke unto them, his disciples, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and on earth. How much power? All power. Here's my favorite slide, the ultimate bomb, one of my favorite pictures of Jesus. John 6:63 says, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Look at that picture. Isn't it beautiful? Jesus Christ, Lord of Lords, King of Kings, has all power in heaven and on earth. He wants to give you the ultimate bomb. And let's look at this for a minute. There's two types of bombs. We have Satan's bombs and we have God's bomb, B-A-L-M. Let's look at them and contrast them for a second. Satan's bombs, God's bomb. Satan's bomb has selfishness. God's bomb, selfless. Satan's bomb is temporary. God's bomb is eternal. Satan's bomb dissipates. God is ceaseless. Satan's bomb is hate. God's bomb is love. Satan's bomb destroys. God's bomb restores. Satan's bomb is random chaos. God's bomb is very intentional. Satan, negative effects. God, positive effects. Satan, prideful. God, humble. Satan hurts. God heals. Satan enslaves. God frees. Satan is lawless. God is lawful. Satan is the lowest of order. God is the highest of order. Satan is exclusive. God is inclusive. Amen. Satan's bomb separates. God's bomb brings us together. Satan's bomb is chaotic. God's bomb brings order. Satan's bomb wounds. God's bomb heals. Satan's bomb kills. God's bomb brings life. Satan's bomb brings tears and is tearful. God's bomb brings joy. It's joyful. Satan's bomb is painful. God's bomb brings comfort. Satan's bomb agitates. God's bomb soothes. Satan's bomb disturbs. God's bomb brings calm. Satan's bomb brings disease. God's bomb, cure. Satan's bomb is a troublemaker. God is a peacemaker. Satan's bomb brings stink, putrefying smells. God's bomb brings a sweet perfume. Satan's bomb brings darkness. God's bomb brings light. Satan's bomb blinds. God's bomb restores sight. Satan's bomb brings tragedy. Tragic. It's very tragic. God's bomb is redeeming. Satan's bomb is hellish. God's is heavenly. Satan's bomb brings sadness. God's bomb brings happiness. Satan's bomb is noise. God's bomb brings quiet. Satan's bomb binds and God's bomb alleviates. That, my friend, is the ultimate bomb. John 1:12, it says, but as many as received him, to them gave he the power, the right, the authority to become sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. And this is a great scripture, John 8:36, it says, and if the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. Indeed is more than we can imagine, more than adequate, free indeed. Oh, look at this, folks. 2 Peter 1:16 says, "For we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we were made known unto you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses to his majesty." Satan loves cunningly devised fables. He loves to have us at the movie theater or sitting in front of our TV watching some reality show that gets us hooked and has us watching over and over. Meanwhile, we know those shows are cunningly, that means stealthily, sneakily devised as calculated fables, which is a flat out lie. But we have not followed cunningly devised fables because we have the balm, and that balm, B-A-L-M, is the balm of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hebrews 4:12 says, "For the word of God is quick," that's alive, "and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." That's God's word. That's what we want in our heart. Change your thinking, change your life. This is a wonderful thought chart that I believe you will love. It says here, "My thoughts, good or bad, determines my decisions. My decisions determines my actions. My actions determine my habits. My habits develop my character. My character determines my destiny." Isn't that powerful? So God is trying to tell us, where are our thoughts? Our thoughts is the base point, and this is where Satan attacks with the landmines, psychological warfare. He wants us to think what he wants us to think, and what he wants us to think is anything but about God and his word. Amen. This is my favorite picture of Jesus. It is written picture, Matthew 11:28. Jesus says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you," what? Rest. All caps. Jesus Christ wants to give us rest. In the midst that all was going on in this world, he wants to give us rest. That's a very important word, as you'll see. Rest. This is something I learned about a little over 25 years ago by Dr. Rick McKinney. He came up with a program called REST. And what REST is, it stands for rational, emotive, spiritual therapy. We are all rational beings. Amen. We are emotional beings. Amen. And we are spiritual beings. Amen. And guess what? We all are broken. We all need therapy. He came up with this program that I think you'll find very, very powerful. And here are the nuts and bolts, the ABCs of rest. And you'll see my chart here, the ABCs of rest. And you'll see the A in the center, and you'll see there's a minus A. And if you go down, minus B, minus C, minus D, spiraling down. And then you'll see the minus A again, plus B, plus C, plus D, spiraling up. The ABCs of rest. Let's talk about A for a minute. A is activating event. We all have events that happen in our lives, right? Whether they're good or bad, whether they're positive or negative. We're going to have a negative A for a negative event that happened in our life. But A stands for activating event. B stands for our belief about that event. B stands for our belief. C stands for consequential emotions. Consequential emotion. And then D stands for doing or our behavior. This chart captivates everything that happens in our life. When you read the Bible, this very program is all throughout the Bible, and I'll explain it more. A is a negative event. Events happen, and we have thoughts about that event. When we have a thought about the event, we have a choice. We can have a positive thought or a negative thought. And when you have a negative thought, you have a negative emotion. And when you have a negative emotion, you have a negative D, which is doing behavior. And guess what? When you do negative things, guess what? More negative A's, activating events, will happen in your life, and you're spiraling down. Let's take Jesus, for instance. When they crucified him on the cross, I can't think of a more negative A, activating event, in that. Jesus was on that cross, but we know, what was Jesus' thought on that cross? We know Jesus did not sin. We know that he was there for our sins and for the sins of the whole world. They put him on that cross, and the Pharisees were talking like, if you are who you say you are, come down and we'll believe you, right? Now, Jesus had a choice. Jesus could have come down off that cross. Matter of fact, when they went to arrest him in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, you know what? Think not that I can call 12 legions of angels and wipe everyone out. But no, he changed. He stuck with his beliefs. So the negative belief on the cross, the negative event, I'm sorry, he had a positive belief. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's a positive belief about the event. He forgave. And when you forgive, you feel good. And when you feel good, you do good. And guess what? He stayed on that cross. Amen. Matter of fact, he said, Father, into my hands I commit my spirit. Amen. So this is the ABCs of rest. Very powerful chart here, and I'd like to spend more time with that, but I must move on. Okay, here's another slide. This is another tool that I learned from Dr. Rick McKinney. It's called Trace, Erase, and Replace. Trace, Erase, and Replace. It's three questions. The three questions are, what am I saying to myself? What could I say to myself? And what will I say to myself? Past, present, and future. These three questions help take care of the past, present, and future. Those landmines that we struggle with, those bombshells that happen in our life and in our family's life, we can ask questions to others and to ourselves. These three wonderful questions. What am I saying to myself to make myself do this or feel this way? We're checking our beliefs. That's that B in that chart. Our beliefs. What am I saying to myself? Okay, that helps us trace down. What am I saying? What words? Am I worthless? Am I no good? Am I not smart enough? What is it? And then we find that word or words, we ask the next question, which is in the present. What could I say to myself? And this is where God's word comes in. What would Jesus say to me? Amen. And that brings healing. Trace, erase, and replace. So in the future, when we start feeling that negative situation or negative vibe or negative thought or negative, what will I say to myself? That helps strengthen you for the future. So what am I saying to myself? What could I say to myself? And what will I say to myself? And notice Jesus is at that operating table, allowing and supervising that person to trace, erase, and replace. Amen. Romans 12:1, it says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren. Brethren is talking to the fellas. I'm just kidding. I know it's talking to everyone. Believers. Paul says, I beseech you, I'm begging you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. Has God been merciful to us? We know he has. That you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. Paul is saying, hey, put yourself on the operating table by the mercies of God and present our bodies a living sacrifice. Romans 12, 2, and do not be conformed to this world, but be ye what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Don't be like the world. We're not to get caught up in all those cunningly devised fables, those landmines, those bombshells, those IEDs. He's saying, don't be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. Can we change ourselves? No, we cannot. How do we get transformed? By the renewing of our mind, that we may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That is downloading new life. Downloading new life. Do you want new life? I want new life. John 8:32, it says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Amen. The truth shall make you free. Matthew 10:1, and when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power. He gave them what? Power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sicknesses and all manner of diseases. Once we, by God's grace, apply his word to our heart and our minds that help us rid ourselves of that baggage, those bombs that Satan has planted, we are to go. And Jesus gave us power by his, through his name, through his word, to against unclean spirits, to cast them out in all manner of sicknesses and disease. Romans 8:37, nay, and in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. We got the victory, saints. We have the victory. This is my favorite picture because this is the bottom line. And you know, the Bible does say where there's no vision, the people perish. This is the vision. This is where we all want to be. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, be transformed. Be done with the sicknesses of this world. 1 Corinthians 2:9 is my favorite scripture. It says, but as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. This is our goal. Landmines and the ultimate bomb, that, my friends, is the ultimate bomb, where we can live forever throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity. Amen. Praise God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity that you've given us to bask in your word and in the truth. Thank you, dear Lord, for the tools, dear Lord, that you have given us to help us to apply your word where it hurts, to help us to trace those landmines and bombshells and apply your ultimate bomb of healing. And Father, we thank you for this privilege. And Lord, save us into your kingdom, world without end, where we can be with you forever and ever and ever. This is our prayer, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.